Welcome to Keith Bracey's In the Clubhouse, my sidelong glance at rugby union matters. Tonight, Chris, I want to talk about the World Cup.
Which is not long.
Not long. It's a year until the World Cup. This time next year, we'll be up to our eyes in scrums, rucks, mauls, hookers, and all things of oval ball persuasion. And I'm going to treat you, mate. I'm going to treat you.
Ooh,
well, most people like a treat, don't they? Chocolatey things you get in the bag, you know. No, seriously, a treat. I'm going to take you to your first rugby match because I know you're a rugby virgin. And I applied for tickets a couple of weeks ago because there was no show last week. Chris was off sunning himself in his little pied-à-terre in Wales or getting drenched, I should imagine. The weather was nice. You do look a bit brown, actually, Chris.
I burnt a lot.
You burnt?
Yeah, did you?
And I gather it's your birthday this week, Chris.
It is, yeah, I'm 56.
56, same age as me, good age to be.
It is, yeah.
56, on the cusp of 60, you know. We're nearly there with our bus passes.
You can tell by the amount of times we've been in the toilets already.
Yeah, well, we have, yeah. It's funny, actually, because Chris went and I had to go as well. I mean, it was like, follow me later, you know, but never mind. No. Anyway,
comes to us all. He does.
Well, you know, we're getting older, and you know, us old blokes.
Yeah.
I bought a brilliant T-shirt in Stratford on Avon in the summer, Chris, actually. It's a pastiche. That's a good word for Monday night, isn't it? A Motorhead T-shirt. But it's got, instead of Motorhead on the top, you know that famous one with the skull with the horns?
Yeah.
It's got Motorshed.
Oh, right.
The place of spades. Not the ace of spades, the place of spades, which I thought was brilliant. But anyway, let's get back to the rugby. I am going to treat Chris, my station owner here, not that I'm trying to get onto his good books, to a game of rugby, as I know he's a rugby virgin. I'm going to take him to Australia against a qualifier this time next year on September the 27th, Sunday, September the 27th, with a 12 noon kickoff at Villa Park. Do you think you'll have to...
Have you ever been there before?
Have you ever been to the Mecca before?
I've been there before. I need to see Blues play, but...
This will be a new experience for you then, won't it?
Yeah.
I'll take you to Villa Park. And I'm thinking of taking your fellow biscuit boy, the Gabby Cabby. Congratulations to the Gabby Cabby who got married at the weekend.
The lovely Sam.
The lovely Sam. Shout out to Sam and Paul. Well done, Gabby Cabby, and your... what does a Gabby Cabby have in his cab? A nodding dog? No. what does he...
It's probably something rude.
It could be. But he's not a cabbie anymore.
He's a cleaning man like yourself. He's like myself, yeah.
He's a cleaning man. So, well done, Paul. Love to see you again, mate. I'm going to treat you and Chris here, the Gabby Cabby, the Biscuit Boys, as they are known. Great show. Give it a listen. To your first ever rugby match this time next year, if I get my tickets,
because because
they're expecting most games to be oversubscribed, and I have had an email from rugbyworldcup.com to tell me that my game is oversubscribed, so I shall go into a ballot, and I applied for 4 tickets. One for me, one for my son, Adam, who had a puncture today on his bike riding to work, so that's a bit, I hope he's okay. And the Gabby Cabby and Chris Brown here, Mrs. Brown, and it come to £80, £20 a ticket, which isn't bad, I don't think, to see an ex-world champion against a qualifier. And we'll probably see a feast of running rugby because, you know, the Aussies will probably run riots against whoever it may be. Could be Georgia. Could be Portugal, if they qualify. Uruguay. Who else might qualify? Russia, they might qualify. Spain, they're an up-and-coming rugby nation with the French there. So, you know, we're looking forward to that. And as I say, anybody who wants to apply for tickets for games at Villa Park or Kingsham in Gloucester or the other local venue is... I don't think they're at the Rico Arena. I don't think there are any tickets for the Rico Arena this time out. But the other venue is... I think it's the King Power Stadium in Leicester.
It's not at
Welford Road because the capacity in Leicester is a lot bigger. It's about 35. And wasn't that a great result for Leicester City against Man United?
Incredible, wasn't it? 5-3.
3-1 up. Man U When have they ever done that? When have Man United ever done that? Fergie would have had a screaming blue murder fit.
That's amazing.
If, I mean, if it had happened under him, he'd have, the teacup would have been, it'd have been a bucket.
Yeah, that's right.
It'd have been a bucket of tea. He'd have thrown at David Beckham and cut his eye. Never mind. Anyway, back to the rugby. So, yes, you can apply up until a week tonight for Rugby World Cup tickets. Just Google, I'm not sure of the website, but Google Rugby World Cup tickets, England 2015. And you'll go on, you have to register, and you can pay by credit card. You get a list of fixtures. You can apply for up to four tickets if you wish. As I say, if your match is oversubscribed, you will then go into a ballot, which is what I've done for my tickets for the games at, game at Villa Park I've applied for. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I don't think I've ever let people listening to my show know this. I actually went to the last time the World Cup was played in England, to the final, which would have been 1991.
Oh, right, okay.
How old was I? I was 33. Just married. Married the same year. Married the same year, 23 years ago. My friend Kim wasn't a lady. He was a gentleman called Kim.
I believe,
scrum half Kim. Every rugby club was given a number of tickets to raffle off or award to good club men. We had a raffle at our club, Dixonians, sadly might be struggling to raise a side this season, but we'll go into that another time. And Kim won the tickets, didn't take his wife, he took me. And we went to the final, and sadly, England lost 12-8. To Australia, would you believe?
So they got to the final.
They have got to the final. Was before. They've been in the final three times, Chris.
Have they?
1991, when they lost to Australia at Twickenham.
Yeah.
In the era of Rory Underwood and Peter Winterbottom and all those great players. Brian Moore, my old mucker Brian Moore. Hello to you, Brian. I'm listening to your show last night on TalkSport. Very good show as usual. And it was that era. Will Carling was captain, of course, and sadly, we lost, but I went to the first time England got to the World Cup final. Then, of course, we won that great game in 2003 in Australia when we beat the Aussies.
Yeah.
17. And then, of course, in 2007, we also got to the final where we lost to the Springboks. Yeah. And, so we've been in. We're one of the better performers. Because, you know, to be fair, the favourites for this World Cup coming up have got to be New Zealand. After what they did to England last summer, they beat us 3-0, albeit in their home turf, you know. But we didn't even come close to beating them last summer. And, you know, first game we did, ran them close, but last minute they scored a try in the corner and won the game. But New Zealand got to be the favourites. And as I always say, for me, as a rugby nut, they are the greatest rugby nation on earth. But they have a tendency to bottle in World Cups. I mean, last time out, it was in New Zealand, 2011, when England covered themselves in ignominy, I'm afraid to say. And Yes, it was. They had some cream for it.
That's right.
Yeah, ignominy. Yeah, it's not very nice. Is it? A bit like hemorrhoids.
Yeah.
But worse.
Yeah.
That's impetigo, I was thinking.
Oh, right.
Yes, not ignominy, impetigo.
Impetigo.
Yeah, you don't want it. It's called scrumpox, you know. Because you can catch it from rubbing cheeks when you're a prop.
And they actually call it scrumpox.
They do. They call it scrumpox. Yeah. But it's also known as impetigo or a nasty skin rash.
Yeah, yeah.
But anyway, we digress. Yes, so, you know, New Zealand, Botley, they only won 9-8 against France in last World Cup final. Mm. And the home turf. The guy that kicked the winning penalties, because it was three penalties to a try and a penalty. I can't even remember his name. He came to Bath, was rubbish, and they got rid of him after two seasons because he was that bad. But, New Zealand are the favourites, I'd say. And I would say possibly the second favourites would be England after that, if they can get the home crowd behind them.
Mm.
Mind you, the cheapest tickets for England games are £75, which is a bit pricey, in my opinion. If you went to see England play in a World Cup in England at Wembley, I suppose you'd probably pay I suppose. But you always lose a bit of a bad taste. They try and make money out of the ordinary fan, and the most expensive tickets are over £300 for the Twickenham games, so Yeah, they are making a bit of a buck, but, you know, we'll see.
Bit out of our price range.
Indeed. Yeah. Yes, yes, us paupers. Yeah. No, but England are in something of a group of death in the Rugby World Cup this time next year. They've got Australia, Wales, and England in that group, and of course only two can progress. It's going to be good. So one of the top 10 nations, either, well, you'd think England would qualify being at home and playing their games at Twickenham. Although saying that, well, Wales have won two out of the last three games they played in when they played England at Twickenham. So, you know, it could be a close call. But I'd take England and possibly Australia to go through, because Wales haven't beat Australia for many, many years now. Going on for about 10 years, they haven't beaten them at home or away. So
10 years.
They were a bit of an Indian sign over the Welsh of Australia. Mm. And they've got a great coach again now, because the ex-New Zealand guy who was coaching them wasn't taking them anywhere, and I think he'd lost his way a little. And I've got an Aussie back in the coaching position now. And you know, they're a crafty bunch, the Aussies. They play a thinking man's game of rugby, you know, because, you know, I was just thinking on the way over here, Oscar Wilde described rugby as a game played by 30 bullies.
Really?
Did you know that?
No. I thought you 30 said something bullies. Else.
But the other phrase he used was gentlemen. It was also a game invented by gentlemen but played by hooligans, and football was a game invented by hooligans played by gentlemen. Yeah. So Oscar had a lot, good. Where is the little mutt tonight, actually?
Oh, he's gone now.
He's gone.
He's home. Is at home.
He's not gone to the great bone.
We took him on holiday with us.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, tomorrow.
You adopted him, aren't you?
He loved it, yeah. Oh. My daughter, who had the dog, who's got the dog, she went over to Turkey, so.
What's his name again?
What's his name? Ted.
Shout out for Ted. Yeah. Missing you, Ted.
Nutter.
He's a lovely little animal. Yeah. I love little dogs. I love little dogs. Anyway, back to the rugby. Yes, just before I go on to this week's Aviva Premiership Roundup, big shout out to my daughter Sarah, who went off to, amongst much tears and sobbing, she went off to university yesterday, Chris. 18 years of age, never been left home before. Off to study sports coaching and physical education at Cardiff Metropolitan University.
Very nice.
So, good luck, Sarah, and I'll see you in about a month's time, because me and my wife are going down for a weekend.
Well, she'll have had money by then.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Well, I'll have to take a few bob with me. She'll probably need a washing doing as well, won't she?
A few cans of lager.
Yeah, well, whatever. Well, me and the missus are staying in a hotel room, so, you know. You never know what we might get up to. Never mind. Anyway, yes, so back to the rugby and to this week's Aviva Premiership Roundup. Friday night saw a titanic clash at King's Home in Gloucester, which, again, the World Cup theme, is one of the venues for the Rugby World Cup, Chris. And Gloucester scored 22 points, but Exeter Chiefs scored 25, which is a bit of an upset, really, because I don't think Exeter have ever beaten Gloucester at King's Home before. And it signals something of a change of guard down in the southwest there. That was another thing I wanted to discuss this week, Chris, really, just going off on a bit of a tangent. We see that, you know, football is popular all over the country, isn't it, really?
Yeah.
Whereas rugby is played in pockets, really. North of the Midlands, there aren't many clubs. The Sale in Manchester, Newcastle in Newcastle, obviously, Newcastle Falcons, coached by great England great Dean Richards. And you've got Yorkshire Carnegie. Now, Moseley, my club, played Yorkshire Carnegie on Friday night at Billsley Common. Would you know where Yorkshire Carnegie are based, Chris?
Nowhere.
You wouldn't have a clue?
No, I'm presuming they're in
Yorkshire. But would you know which town, which city they're based in?
I'll take a guess and go for Sheffield.
Leeds.
That was going to be my first guess.
But that's the thing about rugby. It's not... Yes, Scotland, Wales... Well, Scotland's a different issue because their rugby is struggling. Although Glasgow Warriors are becoming a really top class club nowadays. Edinburgh struggling really, but really the hotbed of rugby is London in the South East and the South West, and there are pockets in the East Midlands and the West Midlands. Although the West Midlands doesn't have a Premiership club, much to my chagrin. I'd love Moses to get there if they could. Sorry, I didn't mean to spit in your eye, Chris. Good job you're wearing glasses. But you know, mostly, you know, 30 years ago they were a top club, but they chased professionalism and lost a lot of money and kudos, and look what happened to the two clubs they were on a par with then, Leicester Tigers and Northampton Saints. They went from strength to strength and are now bastions. Can I say bastions?
Yeah, of course you can, yeah.
Okay.
Bastions.
Then bastions of Leicester Tigers. Right, yeah, that brings me on to Leicester Tigers got nilled on. They got nilled.
We just invented a new phrase.
Nilled.
Yeah.
Well, but, you know, I was going to go on to Saturday. I mentioned Gloucester losing to Exeter. Just wanted to say that there's been an influx of Celts.
Yeah, you can say Celts, yeah.
Yeah, Celts, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Bastion and Celts. Yeah, for sure. They're Bastion Celts, aren't they? But no, David Humphreys from Ulster is now Gloucester's director of rugby. And they've also imported two big Welsh names, and I mean big, in the form of Richard Hibbard, who is a tattooed, blonde-haired, long blonde-haired hooker. Mm-hmm. Who looks more like a rock star from Guns N' Roses rather than rugby professional. But he's a great British line. He made the difference against the Aussies last time out, a couple of summers ago down under for the British Lions. Really galvanised the front row when he came in after the first test loss. And the other big Welsh name is James Hook. Mm-hmm. I mean, we had a pirate theme the other week. Ha ha, Jimbo. Cornish Pirates. But no, we don't play for Cornish Pirates. He plays for Glass. Glass. Glass.
Glass.
As in Gloucester.
Oh, right, okay. Yeah,
that's
yeah,
what
yeah.
they call glass to their fans. Ah, Glass. But James Hook is mercurial talent. Welsh international. Bit of a utility man, really. A bit of a, what should we say in football parlance? He's a bit of a, what should we say, a James Milner.
Right.
A James Milner, you know.
Yeah.
Often on the bench,
yep.
Brought on to plug a gap or to shore up a defence.
Utility man.
But
yeah,
when they need to win a game and get into attack, they bring on James Hook.
Yeah.
Now, the thing that Hook has now done by joining Gloucester under David Humphreys is to guarantee that he can play fly half.
Yeah.
Which he wants to do because obviously he wants to get into that Welsh team as fly half because. Frankly, what's his name? The two Welsh Royals in position are not good enough, frankly. Yeah. And Hook is really much in that mould of Jonathan Davis, Barry John.
Barry John.
Phil Bennett.
Yeah.
Bennett.
See, I remember all these. It's strange, I remember all the ones from the 70s.
Yeah, well, you didn't.
They were household names.
But you didn't remember it. I bet you couldn't name an English rugby player from the 70s, could you? Could you?
No.
David Duckham? You heard of David Duckham?
Beaumont?
No, he was from the 80s.
Was he?
You were close. He's probably the most famous English rugby player. Yeah. After Johnny Wilkinson, of course. Can you name me one?
Who was the one that went out with Lady Di?
Carling, but he's from the 80s as well.
Right.
70s rugby players. Andy Ripley. Remember Andy Ripley with the long hair? Used to appear in Superstar. You don't remember him, do you?
I don't remember him.
But that's the thing. These 70s Welsh rugby players. I mean, it was helped by the fact that Max Boyce, you know, exemplified them in song, you know, and made them into national legends. You know. Gareth. I mean, I'll keep going on about the fact that I think Gareth Edwards was the greatest ever rugby player. And I'm unanimous in my opinion that Gareth Edwards is the all-time best ever rugby player. And now, this will interest you.
Of all nations?
Of all time. And I'm unanimous. As Hyacinth Bouquet would say, I am unanimous in that. Now, this will just interest you. Just a quick aside. Did you know, last Saturday, I heard Anne Widdicombe speak? Anne Widdicombe.
Right.
I got a view of her calves. because I was sitting right behind her. Anne Widdicombe's calves are so shapely, Chris.
Really?
And you, this woman, Keith, she get.
You need help.
Man. I know.
You need help. You're telling me that Anne Widdicombe's calves were shapely.
Her ankles. I could have got my fingers around her ankles. They were that tiny. But she was a brilliant, brilliant speaker.
Yeah.
I'm a graduate of Birmingham University, Chris. I don't wish to blow my own trumpet.
No. You tell me every week.
But I do, yes. And, you know, I'm an alumnus.
I've called you that.
You've often called me an alumnus, haven't you? Yeah, yes, yeah. I am a bit of an alumnus.
Yeah.
But I'm an alumnus of Birmingham University, and as part of our AGM for the Guild of Graduates and Alumni Society, we had Anne Widdicombe address us, and she stood in front of me like a little dwarf.
Oh, right.
No. Little sprite.
Yeah.
She was like a little sprite. She was fast, bubbly, full of air, you know, like... No, my joke was obviously lost on me.
Sprite.
Anyway, she spoke for an hour. She went from a day as an MP to the time she was on Strictly, you know. She was with Anton Dubek. And her opinion is of Anton that he would have made a great replacement for Brucey.
They're twins, aren't they? They were about 50 years.
Yeah, well, he could have been his son, couldn't he?
Yeah, it could have been.
Could have been his bastard son. Oh, sorry.
Bastion.
Bastion's son, yes.
Could have been his Bastion's son.
Now, honestly, I was so impressed by Anne Widdicombe. I'm not a Tory voter. I've always voted Labour, and now I'm a Green. You didn't know I joined the Green Party, did you?
No.
I didn't tell you, did I? No. I stood for the Greens in the local council elections last May.
Oh, did you?
I did, yes. I'm a Green man.
This man's just gone.
Yeah, in Sandwell Council in Bristol Ward. Oh. I got 148 votes.
That's all right.
But I beat the Lib Dem into last place. Yes.
Yeah, right, okay.
So, you get that quiet. Well, this is becoming like a party political broadcast now, isn't it? Yes. I did keep it quiet because basically I don't see you during the summer, do I?
Because you're not a Farage man, then.
I'm not Farage. The Farago that is Farage. No.
You're not one of
them. No, definitely not a Farage man. I'm more of a Natalie Bennett man. Natalie Bennett.
Yeah,
and bit of a Natalie Bennett because she's the leader of the Green Party, Chris. I don't know whether you knew that. I don't think you did.
No.
Nick Ball, welcome to the show. Do you want to come in?
Yeah, we'll have a quick swap round while I just play a trailer. Here we go.
Welcome back to In the Clubhouse. Just a brief break while we welcome Nick Spall into the show.
It
was a whole packet of M&S briefs, I think, Nick. But anyway, welcome to Nick, who's back amongst the because we'll just have a quick, was that trailer for the Tilt and Talk show
in
about 25 minutes time, just a bit of sport.
That was just a sports radio
anyway. Yeah, well, so back to the rugby. Yes, I was going on about Leicester being nilled, wasn't I? Nilled. Yeah. Leicester were nilled.
Sorry,
I've never known. No. Leicester nilled. It sounds like an American
It hasn't been
author.
A good weekend for Leicester, actually, has it?
No, well, it has, because they beat Man United.
It has been a good weekend.
It has been, but it hasn't been a good weekend for Leicester rugby.
No.
Because they were beaten 45-0 by Bath at the Rec. Shock result. Shock horror result. It really was. It's like Man United getting beaten 5-3 by Leicester.
Really?
It really was.
Shocking, isn't it?
But with the over ball rather than the round ball. So it was shocking. Really shocking. Leicester nilled, yeah. Bath scored 3 tries from over 80 metres. And they have got great pace outside. Carl Eastmond, a young rugby league convert, did so well for Bath. He scored a try and set up another one for former England centre Jonathan Joseph, who's been with Bath for a couple of seasons now. Let's hope these two might play for England in the World Cup partnership in the centres. But as I said, they got great pace outside, but it was up front that Bath destroyed the Tigers. Ex-Gloucester second row enforcer Dave Atwood and England's David Wilson were outstanding as they ground those Tigers into the dust. And, you know, I have never known Leicester go through a game without scoring a point. And to lose 45-0 to Bath, who, they had a good season last season, they didn't get in the playoffs, but they've tended to underachieve over the, since they had that great side with Jeremy Guscott.
So it wasn't an early Bath.
No, it was an absolute drenching for the Tigers, because as you know, cats do not like to get wet.
They don't.
Oh, actually, thinking about it, Tigers love to swim, so that's wrong. But my pussycat at home, Bella, she doesn't like to get wet. And these Tigers, they didn't like it. They didn't like it up them.
Misses.
The wreck. It was a wreck of a game for Tigers, I tell you. Anyway, moving on. London Irish 32, Saracens 36. Now, Sarries once again left it to the last minute. In week one against Wasps, Chris Ashton, the man of the the splash dive, you might have seen him when he jumps up in the air and dives.
Oh, yeah, he drives to lift.
Chris Ashton, yeah, that's right. That's
the man. Chris Ashton.
Chris Ashton, yeah, ex-rugby league man. England winger, but he scored in the last minute against the Wasps in week one, and this weekend, another England player, Billy Vunipola. You wouldn't think he was from Leicester, would you? But
no.
He's not. He's from the Islands, but he's adopted England as his rugby home. And Billy Vunipola, England number 8, scored in the very last minute to defeat the London Irish, who had led the game throughout. Right until the end, and Irish wing Alex Lewington scored a hat-trick. It's not often you'll score a hat-trick and finish on the losing side. Now, last weekend, as I say, there was no show last weekend, so I just wanted to cover a bit of territory from last weekend. Last weekend, Sarries produced the weekend shock result with a 46-0 win over Quins.
Mm.
Again, there's been some weird results this season. I think, I don't know what, you know, Harlequins, again, never knowingly undersold, never not often they're nilled. They've got the great Nick Evans, the All Blacks fly half playing for him. Chris Robshaw, the England captain, although he's no longer the Harlequins captain, he's been relieved of those duties, and fellow England player Joe Marler, as the prop, has become Quins captain. And must admit, I do like the Harlequin shirt. Have you come across that in your travels, Chris? Harlequin's rugby shirt. It's not the hoopy one. It's the one of all the chocolate and black and red and green and pink. It's the Harlequin. The Harlequin.
Of course,
Harlequin with all the different colours in his suit and the little clown. Yeah,
Jester.
But they're Adidas. Yeah. They're Adidas Harlequin shirt. Great. You have to buy me one of them for Christmas.
You want one, don't you?
Yeah, I do.
Tell you what one.
Well, I saw it for the first time on Saturday and the highlight show, but that's another thing I wanted to mention about the World Cup, actually, Chris, because did you know it's on ITV? It's on blooming ITV.
It's good.
The World... No!
Bad!
It's bad!
Why?
The BBC do everything the best.
Oh, right.
In my opinion. Look at the coverage they go to the Olympics.
Isn't it good that it's actually on TV anyway? Doesn't matter.
That's a bit of a... that's a footballer's comment, that is. Rugby? It's just... It's got to be on TV. Rugby's all... Well, I remember Rugby Special, Nigel Starmer-Smith.
Oh, right, yeah.
You wouldn't remember that. You're the same age as me. I was brought up on a diet.
I
was
watching the wrestling.
You were. Jackie Palo.
That's right, yeah.
Giant Haystacks.
That's right.
Big Daddy. Shirley Crabtree.
Yeah.
A.K.A. Big Daddy.
Yeah.
Well, you remember that. Mick McManus.
Yeah.
Johnny Quango.
Yeah.
Kendo Nagasaki.
Yeah.
Les Kelly.
Kelly,
we're going back in time now, aren't we?
Yeah, yeah.
Sorry, this is turning into a wrestling show rather than a rugby show. I apologise.
The Royal Brothers, the Royal Twins.
I don't remember them.
I remember the Royal Twins.
Jackie Palo was the one who was meant to be a bit fey, wasn't he? A bit gay and a bit...
I've got
this
guy from Ellington Spa as well.
Kendo Nagasaki?
No, he's on my Facebook, actually. I can't think of his name. He used to bounce for me in the nightclubs back in the day.
Did he?
Yeah.
Now this will surprise you. Did you know Jimmy Savile was a wrestling entrepreneur, and he used to put on wrestling shows, and he did one at our local pub, the Hen and Chickens, back in the '60s.
Oh right.
And he was a wrestler himself, and not many people know that, because Jimmy Savile is now obviously not. We don't talk about him, do we? Mm. No, never talk about him anymore. But anyway, that's an aside. So yeah. Well, how did we get on to wrestling? Oh, I can't remember. Oh, Billy Vonipola. Anyway, so as I say, Saracens provided another late upset for the Irish, London Irish. And but the Welsh are already down, I think. Mm. London Welsh, poor side. Came up last season from the Championship. They look like relegation fodder already, with losing 46-8 to Sale. And I'll just have a quick canter through, because I can see that the night is moving on. Can you hear that music?
Oh, yes, it's in the background.
The one other result I wanted to give my listeners, my loyal listeners, I gather I've had some interest from some listeners, and we had about 100 replays on, what was it, Spreaker?
On Spreaker, yeah.
Spreaker,
it should be available straight away after this.
That's excellent. Newcastle Falcons 10, Dean Richards' side. Northampton Saints 35. And this is just, there are two 4G pitches, artificial pitches in out of the 12 Premiership sides, mm-hmm. and Newcastle have a new artificial pitch. So that's good foresight, because you can play the game. The other one is at Alliance Park, which is the Saracens pitch. Mm. But there we go. Another great show. Always goes far too quickly for me, because I've got a lot to say. As you know,
we digress so much.
We do digress, but it's all grist to the mill, isn't it, Chris?
It is, yeah. We might have to extend it one of the weeks.
Well, I don't think I could go. I'd probably run out of batteries if I had to go for an hour, but I can talk for England. Anyway, thank you for listening, and good night from Keith Bracey, who was in the clubhouse.
Good night.
Good night, Chris.
Good night, Jim Bob.